In the 1960s, beyond visual range combat would become possible for the first time. Semi-active radar guided technology allowed for an aircraft to locate a target, transmit this information to a missile computer, and then guide the weapon to its target. During this period, no other radar-guided air-to-air missile would see more use than the AIM-7 Sparrow. Employed extensively during the Vietnam War, it would result in 58 MiGs shot down and would be fielded by other militaries across the world. Infamously unreliable in its early iterations, the missile would be developed over the course of decades and continues to serve on the front lines of Ukraine today. The story of the Sparrow begins in the late 1940s as a US Navy program, Project Hotshot, to create a beam-riding air-to-air rocket. As with the Sidewinder, the Sparrow's development was inspired by German guided missile research, though the Sparrow itself was engineered by Douglas and Sperry, starting in 1947. At the behest of the US Navy, initial tests were done in 1947 using a heavily modified HVAR rocket system, which could be guided via beam riding, a method where the missile stays centered within a radar beam projected toward the target. By 1952, this system had been further modified by Douglas Aircraft Company, achieving its first test intercept of a target. Referred to as the AAM-N-2 Sparrow, it would enter service in 1954, but was difficult to operate. However, since 1950, Douglas had been interested in heavily modifying the platform to carry an internal radar system. A concept had been drawn up, referred to as Sparrow 2, AAMN3. Advanced for its time, it would have been an active radar-guided missile with fire-and-forget capabilities. In practice, however, it failed in testing and was abandoned entirely by 1956. In 1951, Raytheon had begun work on the Sparrow 3, a semi-active variant of the missile. Far more achievable than the earlier proposals, it was a promising development. Over the course of several years, the Sparrow 3, officially the AAMN6, would be tested and then rolled out in several initial batches, first entering US Navy service in 1958. The following year, the improved 6A model would be produced, the AIM-7D. And in 1963, the 6B would emerge also, the AIM-7E. That same year, naming standardizations between the US Navy and Air Force would see the Sparrow variants renamed. The cancelled Sparrow 1 and 2 would be the AIM-7A and B, while the AAMN-6, 6A and 6B would become the AIM-7C, D and E respectively. Equipped on the new F-4 Phantom, the Sparrow was perceived as highly capable, although by this point it was yet to see combat. The Echo variant was the most capable. With a range of 22 miles, or 35 kilometers, it could be employed at distances beyond or near the limit of visual range. It was also, by this time, the only variant capable of reliably engaging targets tail-on at opening rates up to 300 knots. The Vietnam War would put the missile to the test. On June 17, 1965, a flight of Navy F-4Bs would effectively employ the missile for the first time. Closing in on a flight of MiG-17s, the lead aircraft fired off an AIM-7D. The missile hit. A second Phantom fired off another Sparrow, hitting a second MiG-17. This engagement would mark the first effective use of air-to-air missiles in the conflict, but despite the success, the missile itself would struggle. As aerial engagements became more common, the weakness of the initial Sparrow variants became obvious. Much like the early Sidewinder, the AIM-7E struggled in the tropical environment, while a variety of limitations, including guidance glitches, fuse malfunctions, motor failures, and limited pilot training, resulted in a probability of kill of around 9%, far less than was expected. In practice, a variety of factors limited the missile's capability to engage targets at mid to short range. Initially designed with the assumption of targeting bombers and other large targets, against small MiGs the Sparrow often struggled. To make matters worse, several incidents early in the war had resulted in restrictive rules of engagement. Given the cluttered skies over Vietnam, pilots had to make visual confirmation of targets before engaging, even after combat tree had been introduced. While two BVR kills would be achieved during the war, for the most part a major strength of the Sparrow had been hamstrung. Essentially limited to close-range fighting, crews would turn to guns or sidewinder. During the war, examination of combat records found that when employed, only around 16% of Sparrows fired would hit their targets. 25% would miss, and the balance would fail entirely due to mechanical or electronic faults. In 1969, a new model would emerge, the AIM-7E2, commonly called the Dogfight Sparrow. It was a direct response to the failures of earlier models in Vietnam, where restrictive rules of engagement often forced Phantoms into fights of close-range maneuvering. The E2 featured clipped delta wings to improve agility at shorter ranges, a modified fuse designed to work more reliably during high-G launches, and circuitry changes intended to reduce the high failure rate that plagued earlier missiles. These adjustments shortened the minimum engagement range and allowed the missile to be fired more safely during the violent maneuvering of dogfights. In practice, however, the improvements were modest. Reliability issues, such as premature detonation, motor failures, and erratic guidance, remained common, and pilots often resorted to ripple firing multiple Sparrows at a single target to increase the odds of a hit. Even with the E2, the missile's probability of kill rose only slightly, to about 13%, which was still far below expectations. By war's end, the missile had proven that semi-active radar-guided missiles were useful in theory, but the technological hurdles and battle space limitations would ultimately make or break such a missile. Pilots had found the missile finicky and unreliable overall, oftentimes resorting to simply ripple firing the missile. Part of this was attributed to a lack of training in the realm of radar-guided missile employment, but technical faults nevertheless meant a high likelihood of missile failure, even if all launch parameters were met. With lessons learnt, improvements would be drawn up, and the Sparrow would live on. In 1976, the AIM-7F entered service, representing a major redesign that finally addressed many of the shortcomings revealed in Vietnam. The missile incorporated solid-state electronics, which were far more resistant to vibration, heat, and age-related degradation than the older vacuum tube systems. By reducing the size of the guidance and control section, designers were able to move the warhead forward and install a new dual-stage rocket motor in the rear, giving the missile both a boost and sustain phase. This change nearly doubled the missile's maximum range compared to earlier models, extending its effective reach to over 70 kilometers in ideal conditions. The AIM-7F also carried a larger 88-pound continuous rod warhead, improving lethality against tougher or larger targets. Together, these changes gave the Sparrow a new lease on life, allowing it to serve not only on the upgraded F-4E Phantom, but also on newer fourth-generation fighters such as the F-14 Tomcat and F-15 Eagle. By the late 1980s, even certain F-16s were adapted to employ the missile, a sign of the confidence restored in the design. In 1982, the AIM-7M entered service as the definitive form of the Sparrow before the advent of AMRAAM. Unlike the Foxtrot model, which had been an extensive upgrade of the AIM-7E, the Mike variant was effectively a new missile built on modern digital electronics. Its centerpiece was an inverse monopulse radar seeker, which greatly improved accuracy and made the missile far less vulnerable to jamming and countermeasures. For the first time, Sparrow could reliably engage low-altitude targets against ground clutter and maintain lock under heavy ECM conditions. The AIM-7M also introduced an active radar proximity fuse and a reprogrammable digital guidance computer, giving it a degree of adaptability through software updates. In service, these changes translated into a missile that pilots could trust. It could be employed at low altitude, against maneuvering fighters, and even in electronic warfare environments that had crippled earlier Sparrows. The 1991 Gulf War would see the missile put to the test once again. This time, however, the Sparrow would prove itself reliable. Over the course of Operation Desert Storm, 44 AIM-7Ms would be fired. Of these 44 launched, 30 would hit their targets, with 19 being achieved at beyond visual range. In the final analysis, the AIM-7M had a hit rate of 68% and kill probability of around 55 to 60%, a dramatic turnaround from the less than 10% effectiveness seen in Vietnam. The final iterations of the Sparrow family were the AIM-7P and the AIM-7P Block 2, introduced in the late 1980s and 1990s. These were essentially refinements of the AIM-7M, incorporating updated guidance software to improve performance against low altitude and maneuvering targets. The Block 2 added a rear-facing data link, allowing mid-course guidance updates from the launch aircraft, which enhanced accuracy in long-range engagements. Though effective, these upgrades came late in the Sparrow's service life, as the AIM-120 AMRAAM was already entering frontline units. As a result, the AIM-7P saw only limited deployment before the Sparrow was phased out in favour of active radar missiles. Since 1991, the AIM-7 Sparrow has remained in service with numerous air forces worldwide, though in steadily declining numbers as the AIM-120 AMRAAM became the standard active radar missile. The US Air Force phased the Sparrow out during the mid-1990s, while the US Navy and Marine Corps continued to employ it on F-14 Tomcats and FA-18 Hornets into the 2000s. By the late 2000s, US frontline fighters had fully transitioned to AMRAAMs, ending the Sparrow's long tenure in American service. Yet the missile has not disappeared. The Naval RIM-7 Sea Sparrow, a ship-launched surface-to-air adaptation, remains in use with many allied navies. Most strikingly, in 2023, the United States supplied Ukraine with stocks of RIM-7s, which were ingeniously integrated into Soviet-designed Buk SA-11 launchers to create hybrid air defense systems. In this configuration, Ukraine has been able to employ Sparrow missiles from the ground against cruise missiles, drones, and aircraft, placing a Cold War weapon once again on the front lines of a modern war. Over the course of its long service, the Sparrow's greatest contribution was not just its tally of combat kills, but the precedent it set. Even in its flawed early years, the AIM-7 proved that guided missiles, rather than guns, would dominate future air combat. It forced air forces to confront the challenges of radar resolution, electronic countermeasures, and the realities of engaging at ranges where the pilot could no longer see the enemy. Those lessons drove the evolution of aircraft sensors, pilot training, and eventually the development of active radar missiles like the AIM-120 AMRAAM. In this sense, the Sparrow bridged the gap between the gun-armed jet fighters of the 1950s and the networked, stealthy, missile-centric air forces of today. Its legacy is less about its imperfect record in Vietnam or its redemption in Desert Storm, and more about shaping the technological and tactical foundations of modern air warfare, where long-range sensors, electronic warfare, and stealth define the battle space.